We're almost ready. People are loading in. We're listening to Caged Elephant off the Unpeeled album, and this has come a little closer. It's a throwback to our first video with Marvin Gaye, Distant Lover.
Mm-hmm.
I think here we're saying come a little closer. We miss all of you, so wish you were all here. It looks like we're getting closer and closer to welcoming people back to the beautiful Napa Valley. Bluebird weather. We've got blue skies and birds chirping. It's springtime here. It's a nice balmy day. Shorts weather out in Napa Valley. We're looking at it's high 70s. For all of you that are in some cold climate right now, you should get out to the Napa Valley as soon as we open back up because
we miss you.
We miss you, and the weather's great out here. So. The vineyard crew is busy mowing down weeds that are growing faster than we can mow, and vines are sprouting out, shoots are shooting, and we've got a busy crew out suckering the vines. That's where we take out the extra shoots and try to focus the energy of the vines on the shoots that we want to keep. Bloom will be in the next couple of weeks, and things are off to the races. So even though we've got this crazy virus thing going on with people, the vines don't care at all. They're doing what they do, and looks like a great growing season. So
is it too early to tell what kind of vintage this will be or how it's going
to
look?
Yeah, it's totally too early to tell. We can't even imagine the nascent grapes. We had a pretty brutal little frost season. We had an early bud break, so things got off the races, and then it got tragically cold, and we ran wind machines and tried to run around and keep the little nascent buds from getting frozen off, and that was largely successful. We saved the farm, which is cool, a lot of hard work on doing that, but we've got healthy shoots that are growing.
Okay.
We didn't have a lot of rain this year, so
right.
The West Coast is in a what they're calling a mega drought. We had about half a normal rain, which to me seems like that's normal nowadays.
Right.
So I don't know what that means, but it was a drier year than normal. But we had a pretty wet year in the last couple of years, so maybe there's some ground moisture there that's latent from those other years. I'm not too worried. We seem to have plenty of grass growing and shoot growth, so it seems like game on, normal business. Could be a great year. Could,
yeah.
You know, we don't know. Most of when we decide whether a vintage, we're going to talk about a couple different vintages. I think the advertisement for this vintage or this tasting was the 2012. The 2012 Leopoldina Cab. And Carrie and Tom thought well enough to hook me up with a bottle of the 2010 Leopoldina.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got that on the table too. And then I just dipped into the winemaker's vault and pulled out a 2012 Pura. So
why not?
Yeah, why not? It's Tuesday somewhere, or what? It's Thursday.
Thursday.
It's Thursday somewhere. So
NFL draft day.
It's NFL draft day.
Not already watching that.
Yeah. So, anyways, we're gonna enjoy some wines and check those out. But in those vintages 10 and 12, we had no idea what the vintage was gonna bring. 10 was a natural vintage in that the generosity and richness of the wines just come right through, and 12 was a more hard fog vintage where there's more tannin structure. The wines are still young by that definition. When we taste the wines, we'll get into what that tastes like, what that feels like, and why that was, and what the future for those wines yields. But a lot of fun stuff. Anyways, I think probably we seem like we've got a good fan club. Thanks for joining us. We've got actually, I wanted to give a shout out. I don't know if is Mark online yet.
I'm not sure.
What? Okay, we've got Mark Sandberg, and whether he's online or not, maybe he'll catch the rerun of this thing or not, but...
happy birthday, Mark.
Happy birthday, Mark.
We new daughters.
Yeah, we understand that the whole clan is zooming in with us, or YouTubing in, or whatever it's called, Mark, we wanted to wish you a happy birthday. You know, we have a ton of fans and friends. Our fans become friends, our friends become fans. You know, our customers become family, and that connectivity between people that first find us for our wine and then later we connect with on a level that's beyond wine. And hopefully these videos are a little bit of doing that. That spirit, Mark's having an important birthday today, and he's sequestered somewhere. So if everybody could raise a glass to Mark. And everybody else that's having a birthday, happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
To everybody, and Mark. cheers. So Carrie and I are taking our first sip of the 2010 Leopoldina.
Yes, Peter, is this the order you want to maybe be drinking in?
You know, I lined them up by vintage. So I've got the 2010 Leopoldina, 2012 Leopoldina, and the 2012 Pura. I think probably most of you are drinking a Mai Tai or a gin and tonic or a shot of tequila or wine from somewhere else or whatever. Any of it's all good. There's a world of fantastic wine. We make some of the world's best wine. And obviously, since you're tuning into this, you already know that and think that. So we're honored and humbled that you're willing to spend a bit of your time with us and chat with us about what's going on at Turnbull. The wines at hand here are all from the Leopoldina vineyard. So Turnbull's, we have three vineyard designates that we create. Last week we were talking about all three of them, the Fortuna vineyard, the Menus vineyard up in Calistoga, and the Leopoldina vineyard. And those are three vineyards that we really focus on in terms of having different attributes. And a couple of our fans, John Horn and Shirley amongst them and some other people, really commented that last week it was enlightening. Long-time fans have had lots of bottles of Turnbull, but have maybe never done a horizontal tasting across the different vineyards. And it was instrumental to really open up the idea of why it is that we bottle these separately.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's kind of cool to go from the 15s last week, which was a fantastic vintage, and then look at the different vineyards, and they could have been more different.
Right.
They were really, really different.
Yeah, very distinct.
And this week we're going to dive into Leopoldina on its own, different vintages. So kind of a different look at a way to look at wine.
Mm-hmm.
Each vineyard has its own story, and then each vintage has its own story. So
do you want to dive into 2010,
yeah.
Leo? Let's take a sip.
Yeah, let's do that.
And then we'll dive into the story.
I love that. Thanks, Carrie, for
keep
keeping us on track. So the 10 Leo, which since it's a surprise tasting that you didn't know we were going to be tasting, but maybe we didn't even know we were going to taste this. Tom's working the camera and the computer over there. If you have any questions, Tom's the guy that's going to be transmitting though. We've reoriented the microphone today so that when Tom transmits the questions, you'll be able to hear Tom's lovely voice. He whistles like a bird. When you hear Tom come in with a question, Tom says that we do have a little bit of the 2010. I think we didn't totally dive into what the scores or the blends were on these wines, but the 10 and 12 Leopoldina were both like 97-point wines. Mm-hmm. So this is a very, very special vineyard, a world-class vineyard, really an amazing spot. We talked a little bit about that last week with the 2015. And here we have the Ultra Specials 10 and 12 vintages, mm-hmm. which are also great. And then we're going to get into the Piera, which is a single vineyard block. We've been getting a lot of questions about what is a Piera. Mm-hmm. And so that's a single vineyard block from the same vineyard. So 10 Leopoldina, the aromatics on this wine are stunning. Mm-hmm. The density and richness. And now at 10 years of age, the bottle bouquet is really expanding. And so the wine, I think we've heard me say it before, but I think of wines as best from Napa Valley and many places in the world in terms of red wine between 5 and 10 years past the vintage date. And this is now 10 years past the vintage date. So it's kind of at its pinnacle. And the 10 vintage was a very, very special vintage. It was it was my fourth vintage at Turnbull, my third year. And such a lucky time to be making the wines from the amazing Turnbull vineyards because the 10 vintage was such a special vintage. Power and opulence, driving, you can almost smell the passion. I don't know like how you tone that up, but it's a real deal. When you smell that wine, the 10 Leopoldina, if anybody has a 10, if you're not opening it right now, then save it for a very special occasion because it's a really special wine. You've done well by being a member of Turnbull and having access to these wines for a long time. Mm-hmm. This would have been something like if you were a member in 2013, maybe, you would have had this wine. So all those people that have been with us for a long time, and Turnbull is legendary for having members that stay with us longer than anyone else. And that's special. Part of that family affair. Mm-hmm. We respect and honor and love you, and without you helping us make wines, we don't get to do it. We mean that from the bottom of our hearts. It's a team sport, and you're a really important part of the team. So the 10 Leo, the aromatics are of there's again that I think last week with the 15 we're talking about the tertiary tones of like roasted sage and tobacco box, and here that's there. But the fruit opulence is like coming, is like blooming outside of that, coming over the top of that. It's pretty great.
Rose.
Yeah, it's a yeah. There's a wonderful cascade of cassis and dark cherries and berries that are coming up through this this capstone of sage and rustic tones of tobacco leaf and smoke in a good way.
I get a little like spice, mm-hmm. like black spice.
Yeah, there's some like that guy with the restaurant with the long pepper grinder. Who knows how long the peppercorns have been in there? But this has been in there for 10 years. So, but it's a subdued brown spice,
mm-hmm.
and then uplift, and then the mouthfeel is generous and wide. It's laking out to the sides and then folding out forward, mm-hmm. in a very powerful and consistent way that brings the tannin structure from that mid palate and then keeps it dimpling out and laking. It's really a fantastic wine. That's very it's kind of everything I could hope for that wine. It's amazing.
So of the characteristics you just described about this wine, what would you say are kind of some of the defining, I'm sure we can discuss this throughout the flight, but some of the defining characteristics of this vineyard that we'll maybe see throughout this flight?
I like it. I think of the Leopoldina Vineyard. The historic name there is the White's Vineyard. So we do sell some fruit to some other partners, Carter Sellers, Maybeck, and they do a fantastic job. So if you're not familiar with their wines, you want to check those wines out. And they'll have those under the White's name, same vineyard. Those characteristics of all his wines, you can taste them across different producers, same vineyard site, really have a strong structural and textural verve to them. So the wines have a monolithic core of structure and texture. And I guess sometimes I'm trying to talk to people about how it is that wine of place and time is constructed. And instead of being like a ceramicist where you're making a coil pot or a pinch pot or you're taking bits of clay and building something out of it, I think of this kind of winemaking, instead of a technical winemaking where you're making it, the art of this winemaking is having a huge stone ingot. And as a winemaker, my job is to like imagine inside the stone the wine and then like whacking off parts of the stone and then finally like very fine sandpaper to try to reveal the pieta inside the stone. I mean, it's like, I'm not Michelangelo, but it's like imagining inside this piece of marble what's inside. And it, so there's nothing you can do when you have a vineyard of this kind of importance. There's nothing you can do to make it better. You can't make the grain inside the stone better. It's about the restraint of like, wow, that's an amazing piece of stone, and then understanding how to take edges off the stone to reveal what's inside.
Yeah.
And so across this whole set of wines, we're going to see that same structure and texture, that the grain of stone, if you will, that allows these wines to be. And, you know, my job is to try to show off what's cool about the stone grain.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds kind of silly, but that's really the truth of how it works. There are wines in the world that are made out of like bits of different wines, and you glue them together like a ceramicist. Not to disparage ceramicists, but it's not a constructive process with this wine. It's a very deconstructive process where you're trying to like just reveal the purity inside.
Yeah.
So the 10 was a magic vintage. I think it was. I started with the 2007 vintage. Mm-hmm. It was the highest scoring wines that Turnbull had ever had. At the time, which was a good year to start. It bought me a little bit of time. I didn't get fired that week, which is cool. And then the 2010 vintage came along, and by then I had a couple of vintages under my belt, understood the individual vineyard blocks, and I think that's really when Turnbull in the modern era like took flight, was the 2010 vintage.
Yeah.
Where we were able to like utilize a couple of years of knowledge under my belt.
Mm-hmm.
Of what the vineyards were, and then it was a spectacular vintage. We fine-tuned the cooperage program, so we like honed in on a couple of important coopers that don't overshadow the amazing fruit we have. So that was really important. I think in the first episode I talked about Atelier and maybe D&J and a couple of other partners that help us focus on our fruit without overpowering that. So the French cooperage, the barrels that we use, is very important in terms of highlighting what's so special about the vineyard sites. And I think that starts coming through with the 2010 vintage, where we've learned enough about how to do that. And by the time we get to the 2012, which is the wine that we advertise today, thanks for suffering through the 2010 with us or without us. 2012 is an evolution from the 2010. I don't think the 12 vintage is the vintage that 10 was, but what a win when we can make even better wine from a slightly subservient vintage.
Right.
I mean, it shows the art of craft or the art of restraint. I think we improved. The 10, the 12, I think, Karen and I looked this up, and I think it was Wine Advocate, 97.1. Yeah. So, and Tom says he wisely stocked a few cases away in the library. So some of you were wise enough to bring some in before this tasting. Mm-hmm. And for those of you that are missing out right now, and instead you're drinking, some other wine, and you wish you were drinking this, there's still a chance.
Yep.
aromatically, there's more finesse. Mm-hmm. There's more red fruit and lift. So it's kind of interesting to see just what 2 years of aging do between the 10 and the 12. The 12, I think, has just like more buoyancy. It's a little bit more feminine. Which is, makes sense for me with the 10 vintage was like so like elbows out, like shoulders broad, like I'm the vintage of all time. And then the 12 vintage was like, I'm a vintage. And so the 12 vintage at the time seemed kind of acidic and more shrill and lean than the 10 vintage. The 10 vintage was like more plush and broad. But now, 8 years later, the 12 vintage, I think is spectacular.
It's really elegant.
Yeah.
It's really elegant.
There's more elegance.
So there's 8 years of aging on this, 10 mm-hmm. on the 10. From, you know, the collector's perspective, the winemaker's perspective, if you were to age these wines, what is the best condition to age?
Yeah.
Such a wine.
I mean, the best conditions would be to, like, maintain, I mean, you know, the wine, like, a lot of people, like, store their wine, like, above their fridge or in the coat closet or something like that, and that's maybe not the way to go. You know, most wine wants to be hanging out at, like, 58 degrees and, like, have darkness and cool. That's consistent.
Is consistency the main factor there? Because I think we get that question a lot. And, you know, is temperature fluctuation maybe the most dangerous thing?
Yeah, I would think that, like, small temperature fluctuations aren't that important. You know, if you're, like, ramping up from, like, 55 to, like, 62 and staying in that 7-degree range, I think that's fine. But you don't want to, like, see your wine get up to be, like, 65 degrees. Mm-hmm. So there's actually, like, at my house, you know, you can go on, you know, Craigslist or something and find somebody that's ready to sell a wine cooler. You can get, a fridge-sized wine cooler for not that much money. And mm-hmm. considering the amount of money that all of you have probably put away in securing and saving awesome wines, it's a pretty reasonable expense. You can buy one used. They're like plywood boxes that are insulated, and you keep your wine in them. You throw it in the garage, and it looks fine. That's one way to go. I have a double wide one in my garage, and I can fit like 20 cases in it. And it's a great way to have wine that's safe, and it's not that expensive as a percentage of the expense that you're spending on wine.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good idea. Wine storage is an important feature. If you're going to store wines like this for a long period of time, you want to make sure that you're not damaging them from storage.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to be like absolute. It's not some sort of religion about exactly how to do it, but it just in general, like colder slows down aging and consistency slows down aging. So you want to like try to be colder and consistent, but not in your fridge. So these wines were, of course, stored perfectly in our estate cellar.
What time do you think they are right now as you're drinking them?
You know, I pulled these out of the 2010 and 12 Leopoldina came out of our tax pit room, which is held at a consistent 58 degrees. Mm-hmm. And the Pierre I brought out of the barrel room in the winemaker's vault, and it's 57 degrees back there.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I brought them in here about a half hour ago. So they're probably about 62 degrees. They're probably like a little cold for drinking, but over the course of this tasting, they're going to warm up and be right in the zone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the idea of like drinking red wine at room temperature is like British castle without heating temperature in the 1800s. So that's like 65 degrees.
Yes.
So in general, like, you know, if you've got red wine stored in your house, and it's, 68 degrees in your house or something, like, give it a couple minutes to chill in the fridge before you pop open the cork, and I think you'll have a fresher, better experience of the wine. And then you'll get to see how it evolves and changes as it warms up in your glass. And speaking of which, the glass is important. I mean, there's companies that sell all kinds of glasses, and there's special wine glass shapes for all kinds of different wines. And that's not total hootenanny. But the glass that we use at Turnbull, most of you have been to Turnbull. It's a Chasse Sweet Soul. What is it? The Grand Cru Bordeaux or something like that.
Yeah.
You can actually, it's surprising, you can pour an entire bottle of wine in this glass.
Yeah.
Don't judge that I've got I don't know, a fifth of a bottle of wine in my glass.
It's a glass.
It's a glass. It's still a glass. It's not an airplane pour. But these glasses are fantastic,
mm-hmm.
And they allow the wine to evolve and change. There's no, we don't like make money on selling glasses or anything like that, so I'm not trying to talk you into it. But this is a great glass, and you can use it for pretty much anything. I actually, at our house, we use it for champagne.
Yep.
It's great for pretty much
everything. Beer glasses, too.
What?
Beer glasses.
Yeah, beer
yeah.
glasses, too.
Pass
so,
it up.
Yeah, so they're a good glass. And if you are having a hard time finding them, I'm sure that I or Tom or Karen could point you to somebody that can hook you up with some of them.
Yeah.
We have a few questions coming in, so I wanted
questions.
To dig into these. Jennifer wants to, she said, tell us more about your estate cellar. Did you reference estate cellar? Were you talking about where?
Oh, yeah. Well, when we open that belly back up, maybe we'll have to have a cellar party.
Yeah.
I don't know. We could do something that's fun. Tom and Carrie have a good program where we library a little bit of wine. So we put 5 to 10 cases of all of our special wines away every year. And that's why we have the opportunity to offer 2010 and 2012 Leo Baldina, or even the, I don't know if we have any here anymore, but those wines are only possible to the membership if, because we can store them on site.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a little bit of a vault that we put a small amount of wine in. It's very modest by most programs.
It's pretty modest.
Yeah.
It is just a room that's temperature controlled and it's got racks of boxes of wine. But it's really where it's where we keep that wine.
It's where we keep that wine.
Talk a little bit about the Leopoldina versus maybe the other cabs, and then maybe your feelings. I think you expressed that Leopoldina is, you know, a special vineyard for you.
Yeah, the question is, how does Leopoldina relate to the other vineyards? So Turnbull has 4 estate vineyards. We have the home vineyard here at the winery itself that many of you have enjoyed wandering around. And some people have had more fun in the home vineyard than other people. I think there were a couple of children conceived in the home vineyard over the years. The Leopoldina vineyard is a special vineyard. And it's up on the top of what we call the Oakville Bench. I think the Rutherford Bench people have a trademark on that, so we're not supposed to use the bench name, but essentially it's a volcanic landslide, and it set a plateau at about 700 feet off the valley floor, and that gets kind of full day sun, and the fog bank sits about 2 feet below it.
Mm-hmm.
So you really get a nice opulence, but a cooling breeze there that gets us fully ripe, but maintains acidity. And then those red volcanic soils, high iron content, the soils are red because they're rusting.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of iron in that soil. It's degraded lava. And that causes the vines to have natural acidity. I'm not a molecular biologist or a chemist, so I'm a grape grower. But for reasons that I don't understand, it works.
Mm-hmm.
And so those soils, that altitude, that fog pattern, the wind breeze there, makes for special wines.
Yeah.
So when you have something that's great, you don't totally question exactly how the gears work. But I know after working with that vineyard for now 14 vintages that it's special.
Mm-hmm.
The vineyard designated wines, the Fortuna, Menus, and Leopoldina wines are priced exactly the same, and I think that's really important. I don't want to give people an opportunity to think that we think that one of them is better than the others. There are
mm-hmm.
special spots, and I think last week in the 2015 tasting,
yeah.
My favorite was actually the Menos cab. And in some years it's the Fortuna cab, and some years it's the Leopoldina cab. This week we were focusing on Leopoldina by itself. But there's not a betterness. Different sites are better in different vintages.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be a shame to indicate to you which one was best by changing pricing or changing how we talk about them. They're all really special spots. One of our customers had the wisdom to notice that I was talking about them like they were my kids, and that's exactly
mm-hmm.
true. And you might have a kid that's great at sports and a great kid that's a great reader and a kid that's great at math. and they're different kids, and they need different, you know, they need different encouragement and pats on the back and gold stars and all that stuff. And they're all wonderful in their different ways. And there's not one that's going to be more successful or less successful, or is more worthy of a hug or a kiss. They're just different, and you love them for what they are.
Beautiful. Tom, do you have any questions, or want us to get
some
care?
I have one from somebody, something about they want to hear more about the children conceived in the home.
Oh, okay.
But I don't know. Is that an inside joke?
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
Is that Tyler?
I don't know. It's not. I don't think there have been any children.
We do have quite a few engagements that happen on the property. It's a beautiful,
yeah.
Beautiful place, and actually, it's a nice.
Terry, thanks for keeping the classes.
Oh man. Let's talk about the Piero.
So, the you know, it's kind of funny. So
we're
going to
use that at the beginning of the video. Russ says he has a gutter mind, so
yeah.
He's just
okay.
So we're going to talk about the 2012 Piero. but it's funny. I also buy wine, and I'm not a member of any other winery, but I get emails from all kind of wineries, and a lot of people are doing these online tastings. And I got one today that was like ridiculous. It was like being explosive about what they were going to offer and how fun they were going to be. And the pictures were with people with like face tattoos and stuff. It was intense.
Oh, man.
I don't want to like bring extra drama to the tasting to like try to get butts in the seats.
We could have dressed up characters from, what's that, Tiger King?
Oh, yeah. That would be cool.
I saw one tasting
really?
Where the people on the tasting were dressed
up
as Carol Baskin and
Joe Exotic.
That's awesome. We should do that next week. Okay, so we've got a plan for next week.
Pass.
Is it over?
I mean, we
okay.
could do it, but
cool.
We could pass. Keep it classy, right?
Yeah. We could go as like the people from, Arzo. Ozark. Yeah, that'd be cool.
Sorry.
Really?
What?
It's a pretty great show. I could be a money launderer, and Carrie could be...
Jason Bateman?
Yeah.
That's the only person we have in that
yeah.
show.
So 12 Piero. And so I just wanted to see how this is doing with the 12 Leo.
Mm-hmm.
So, 2012 vintage.
When did you start making Piero? Can you start a little?
Yeah. Piero, project started really the genesis of the Piero project was 2007, but we didn't actually make one until 2010.
Mm-hmm.
So in 2007, we had 3 barrels of wine at the Menes property in Calistoga that were just, they're just the best 3 barrels I'd ever seen in my life.
Mm-hmm.
At the time, I think I had 15 years of wine making under my belt, made some great wines. And, those 3 barrels were really special, and I wanted to bottle them on their own, but we didn't really have a project for that.
Mm-hmm.
We had the Menes bottling and they could have gone into that, but they were so good that I did place them into the 2007 Black Label, which is a spectacular
mm-hmm.
one.
Okay.
Last time I had one of those, it was super. So if you've got a 2007 Black Label, you're
Tom,
not.
Did we have any 2007 Black Label?
Man, I don't think so.
Yeah.
Okay.
But so we had these 3 magic barrels.
We might have a couple bottles, but nothing
yeah.
I could tell you for sure. So.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so it started me thinking about what to do when we have a special barrel.
Mm-hmm.
At the time, I was just new to Turnbull. I didn't really have the bandwidth or the ability to say these should get a bottle on their own, or at least I didn't think I did.
Mm-hmm.
And so by the time the 2010 vintage rolled around, and we had just these magic barrels from the Little Baldino Vineyard from our very steep block,
mm-hmm.
It's about a 45% slope, and it's meter by meter space. It's really fantastic.
The 9th vineyard growing block?
Yeah, it's block 9.
Okay.
So I came to Tom's predecessor and said, look at this is really special. I think we should really do something with this. It needs to be bottled in its own idea. It's beyond Black Label. It's beyond holding a cab. It's really, and if I remove these 2 or 3 barrels from those bottlings, those bottlings remain untouched. So there's this halo that we can like bottle, and we should. And I got the okay to do that, and the 2010 Piero was born. And so we didn't make one in 2011. Because I needed the barrels to make the 2011
right.
Black Label. 11 was a very difficult vintage. The 11 Black Label is still like an award-winning,
it's
awesome wine. The idea is always that any of the wines that we bottle, we would put on our own family's holiday table,
mm-hmm.
Paying full retail above member pricing,
mm-hmm.
and be entirely thrilled and feel like winners for doing so. So the we didn't make an 11 Pira. 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 Piras exist.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the current release is.
16. And obviously there would be no 17.
Yeah.
So 11 and 18, or 11 and 17,
yeah.
Two holes in that.
So in 17 we had, I selected two barrels for Pira again. They were ready to go. I thought they were great. But at the same time, they were on the cusp of being useful. Taking them in or out of the... out of the Leopoldina cam from 17, I thought made a difference. When you can do it something called a duo trio, where you have three glasses of wine.
Mm-hmm.
You'd have two glasses would have the same wine. So like, let's say these would be Leopoldina 17 without the two magic barrels,
mm-hmm.
and this would be 2017 Leo with the magic two barrels. And then if you mix them up and you can't tell which glass is which, then there's no difference. And if you can do that over and over and over again, and I can't tell the difference, then there's no difference. And so that aspect, let me try to unwind my glasses.
You know which order you're
yeah.
In.
So if I were to do in 17, I thought there was like when I did that over and over again, occasionally I could pick out the glass
mm-hmm.
that had the two magic barrels. And I recommended to Tom and Carrie that we don't make a Pira,
mm-hmm.
that I use those two barrels in Leopoldina. And then the two barrels that would have then gotten squooshed out of the bottom of Leopoldina went into Black Label. A Black Label, of course, ended up getting the Venice, thank you very much, Antonio, the 100-point score, which is so humbling and wonderful. So that hard-nosed goal of always making the best wine for our faithful, for our friends, for our family, you know, that pays dividends and we do the right thing. So we didn't make a 17 Pira. There was barrels to make a 17 Pira, but they had a use in making the other wines better. So in 18, we'll have a Pira again. I've
okay.
got the barrels all picked out. It's a puncheon in a single barrel.
Cool.
So they're gorgeous. I'm super
yeah.
excited to get another Pira bottle.
It's a
we'll do that.
How much variance do you see in between the barrel to barrel? How much variance do you usually see in the same?
Lot.
Oh, yeah, a lot. Yeah. There's definitely barrels so there's not one magic barrel, or Cooper or toasting level or Forest that makes everything better all the time. If there was, then we just use that. It's always about looking for the barrel that accelerates, more elevates the particular wine, and for what might be useful for a Menus could be not useful at all for a Leopoldina,
mm-hmm.
could be moderately useful for Fortuna. So it's about trying to like feel that. And so different vineyards are different, just as we tasted last week, and then different vintages are different. So when I'm ordering barrels, you know, my Cooper partners know that I've already placed my orders, and we've just had shoot elongation. So we have shoots about 4 inches long. There's not even clusters there. So I can't taste any grapes. I have no
right.
idea what the summer is going to look like. Hot, cold, rainy, hail. I have no idea. Early harvest, late harvest. I don't know. So I buy a diversity of barrels, and I try to play those into the nascent wines to try to hit the right zone. And then over the course of 2 years of aging, some of them elevate and some of them don't.
Mm-hmm.
That's the art of blending and possibilities. The Pira is really the one that hit. It's like that magic fishing day where you like pull out that lunker that, you know, you had no idea. You might've been like fishing with that lure that hasn't caught anything in 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's the year that it strikes. How that works, I don't know.
Yeah.
Or that day out on the golf course and you like, you know, you get a birdie or something and like you hadn't been playing a lot. The course was difficult. There was wind. You know, and things fall together. There's some luck and in favor. You know, I don't know, from like I'm not super religious, but I think from like the wine gods or something, there's something that comes together and it happens when it happens, and it doesn't when it doesn't, and you rejoice and are thankful when it does, and you don't worry about it too much when it doesn't.
Yeah. Is there any so kind of going on that kind of
yeah.
luck and just kind of chance with Pyrrha, are there any year in and year out kind of distinct characteristics and qualities of that in your block that you see, or is it truly more of an expression of that vintage and that element of just luck?
Yeah, you know, we're fortunate in that the Pyrrha block is about 2.5 acres of vines,
mm-hmm.
and you know, which it's very low yielding, but will yield 12 to 16 barrels a year or so.
Mm-hmm.
And so to find just the top edge of that from this very, very special vintage
mm-hmm.
or vineyard doesn't seem like too much of a stretch. I really hold that line very special about, is it special? The 12 Pyrrha that's in our glass here, cheers. And aromatically, I would say compared to the 12 Leo, the 12 Leo is a little bit more baritone and darker brooding aromatics of like fruit density. And I would say that the 12 Pyrrha is a little bit more floral and like has like a little bit more of like a little swizzle stick of aromatic lip.
I would say that there's a lip there.
Yeah, there's something that like is, I guess when I'm looking for the Pyrrha barrels, I'm looking for something that you can't quite put your finger on. Like,
mm-hmm.
I don't know what that is. And then it's that mystery and the intrigue of the unknown that makes it exciting. And you know it when you see it, and if you haven't seen it, then you'll never know it.
Mm-hmm.
But when you smell that, it has this beguiling aromatic of like, there's like these very subtle tea spices and like maybe like a nutmeg or toasted almonds, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
There's like
a little clove,
yeah,
maybe.
Clove, yeah, that's good.
A spice, that kind of savory.
Yeah. This is like savory brown spices.
Mm-hmm.
You can't quite individually pick out anything. It's very complex.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but it definitely draws you in.
Yeah.
And it's about those, across all these wines, of course, you have the aromatic drawing. The 2010, now going back to that, actually has this like really interesting like celery seed and like
mm-hmm.
Black pepper, and like there's a boysenberry, blackberry jamminess to
mm-hmm.
it. That's totally complex by that celery seed and the black
yeah,
pepper.
Yeah, the celery seed is something that's super unique to that wine right now.
And then the
The 12
has this buoyancy of like
mm-hmm.
the boysenberry is like coming up harder. It's more buoyant and red lifted, and has it's a little bit more playful. There's more aromatically, it's more acidic, which is exciting because it does like make you quench a little bit more, draws you in faster.
Yeah.
And then fun, 12 Leopoldina, and then 12 Pyrrha.
Yeah.
And the 12 Pyrrha takes the buoyancy of the 12 Leopoldina, which is like buoyant and like playful,
mm-hmm.
drawing you in, and then with the Pyrrha, it's darker and more resonant,
mm-hmm.
A little bit wider in the aromatics, still drawing in, but without like having the like clever hook of like
yeah.
red fruit.
It actually makes you
kind of easiness.
Want to think about it a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. And then the mid palate like almost looks like dropping down a shaft, and then it widens out. There's like, it's like spelunking or something. You're
yeah.
like in a cave. There's a big cavern, and there's a lot of, I don't know, like natural light, like illuminating the purity of the water or something. It's, it feels fresh and pure, and there's room to explore.
Mm-hmm. And I think one thing to note, we just quickly did the three.
Yeah.
And no matter what, if you have any bottle of Leopoldina Cabernet in your glass, texture and structure is definitely the thing that keeps coming through. And that's kind of, I think, as you discussed in the beginning, Peter, is that signature profile of Leopoldina, that regardless if it's Pyrrha, Leopoldina single vineyard cab, or even a black label that might be predominantly from Leopoldina, you get that texture and structure.
Yeah, it's fun.
So I have a very specific question.
Okay.
Maybe that you're going to text about.
Yeah, somebody was texting me. Making me laugh.
You use the chat, people. Yi Zhang was wondering about the where the Pierre sits, Leopold David Vineyard sits. It's over Bella Ball right next to Bella Ball. He was wondering if you've ever had the Maya from then.
Yeah. So, on the Oko Bench, the road that leads up to Leopoldina, there's Dalla Valls there. Off and below is Peter Michael's Operity, or no, next door is Peter Michael's Operities. Mm-hmm. Down below us is Joseph Phelps's Bacchus Vineyard,
mm-hmm.
Bacchus, and then.
Yeah,
so it's a special spot in comparing it to those other bottlings, which are, you know, 2 to 5 times more expensive.
Mm-hmm.
The Turbo wines take the Pepsi challenge with any of them.
So you can buy 2 to 5 times as many bottles.
You could, yeah. Tom's a consummate sales guy.
We do have 5 cases of 2007 Black Label in existence.
What?
I received a text from our inventory manager.
Oh, good.
Tom is saying that there is 2007 Black Label.
I'm not sure I would sell it, but.
Tom, he says it's not for sale. He's going to keep it all for himself. But yeah, the 7 Black Label is a special one. But, and is the recipient of those 3 magic barrels before Pierre was born, went into the 7 Black Label. It's been a couple of years since I had a 7 Black Label, but the last time I had one, it was a good time.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know, this whole set of wines is remarkable and shows off what's special about Leopoldina and those different vintages.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty fantastic.
Christopher has an interesting question. Based on Leopoldina having that Pierre block, do you feel that any of the blocks at Fortuna or Ameno specifically have a magic block?
Yeah, the Fortuna Vineyard is an older vineyard. It was planted originally before Prohibition and then replanted largely in the 80s. We've been, the family that owns Turnbull has done a wonderful job unleashing us to replant the vineyard over the last 5 years. So currently about half of the vineyard is out of fruit in terms of it's in replant. Starting with the 2018 vintage, the new blocks are coming on board, and by 19 we're back in force. That's exciting. The kind of halo ground, the Fortuna Vineyard, for those of you who haven't been there, it's a 50-acre parcel, and there's blocks that are probably 2/3 of the vineyard is on the official alluvial fan, the red volcanic clay and cobblestone from the base of Leopoldina, essentially. And the bottom third of it is fluvial soil, baleen clay, and sandbars. They're interesting too, but the real sense of place happens up on the alluvial fan.
Mm.
So a lot of that's been a replant, and it comes back on board with it in full force with 2019.
Okay.
So those new plantings, when I came aboard in 2007, the plantings were tiring. As vines age, they become more interesting, but they become less athletic.
Mm.
And so you get a very fresh and feminine interest, but in terms of making a deep and dense Cabernet, they have a hard time doing that. And so a little bit of that's been employed in those older vines have been bringing in the character of plays. And the younger vines, as they fold in, are bringing in the power and density of oak fill. Now, in 2019, we'll have both those components together in the young vines. They now have enough sense of place and the power and density that young vines can bring. And so, now they're 10 years old or something. They're
right.
They're bringing in their fullness. So, I think that eventually those blocks, maybe 10 years from now, will have something both special from place to tell and the vibrancy of having healthy genetic material and reorientation and all the things that go into planting a vineyard. We've captured all of the knowledge that happened over the last 40 years in grape growing to get that perfect.
Yeah.
So that was a... It was a massive expense, but well worth it. It'll pay dividends for all our members that will be with us in 10 years. You'll be pleased to see the Fortuna Vineyard Cabernets become some of our best in the future. And then at Menus, we have a block where the Three Magic Barrels in 2007 came from. The Menus Vineyard is our most on the edge vineyard. It's the coldest, even though it's in Calistoga, and I think Calistoga has a misnomer being a hot grape growing area. It's colder at night, and bud break is later,
mm-hmm.
fall comes faster, hot daytimes, cold nighttimes. We set our smallest crop in Calistoga to try to get it all the way ripe, and the Menus Vineyard is up in the northwest corner. So it tends to, it's our edgiest vineyard. A high risk, high reward. It's a little bit like an investment. When it hits, you're loving it, and when it doesn't, you're not so happy. And so the good news is the Menus bottling every year is a pretty small bottling. What doesn't hit that bottling goes into our wonderful out-in-the-world Napa Valley Cabernet that if you go to a restaurant, when you're doing takeout, and you can get a great bottle of the Turnbull Cabernet, and a restaurant would have been $100. Takeout menu is maybe $60 at your local fine bottle shop. It's $45. This wine, about half of that bottling comes from our awesome Menus Vineyard. And the halo piece of that vineyard goes into our Menus bottling. So great vineyard, but there's a block there, what we call block 11. It's planted meter by meter, just like the Pierre block at Leopoldina. And it's super rocky. It's shattered volcanics. It's about a half acre, and that is where those three Magic Barrels came in 2007. And we've had Magic Barrels there, and that block usually is the cornerstone of the Menus bottling.
Mm-hmm.
In 2011, the rain was coming. I was like hunkered down in a tractor shed with our whole vineyard crew. It was like 5 o'clock in the morning, and it's already like drizzling, like it's already raining. I was like, yeah, so we go now. I'm looking at my Doppler radar on my phone, and the rain cloud is like off the coast of California. It's about, you know, in 2 hours, it's going to be like dumping like 5 inches an hour in Calistoga.
Wow.
And I'm trying to talk these guys into going and picking that. And they're like, no, Jefe, it's raining already. And I'm like, yeah, no, it's drizzle. We go now. And I brought coffee and donuts and all this stuff and tried to get them excited about it, but nobody was coming. Being a farming kid, my dad had taught me how to like drive a tractor and hook up a trailer and load bins and all that stuff. So I'm like, I'm going, and anybody that wants to come with me is more than welcome. And I hopped on the trailer or the tractor and hitched up the trailer and loaded bins, and they were all hunkered down in the shed. I'm soaked in 2 minutes,
mm-hmm.
and I head off, and I can see, a mile behind me, as I crest this ridge, I'm looking back, and the open door, roll-up door to the shed is illuminated, and all these silhouettes are poking out, and nobody's coming.
Yeah.
And I'm picking in the dark with a headlamp in the rain by myself for like a half hour, and nobody's coming.
Jeez.
And it's the magic block at a moment, and I'm hoping to like save the vintage.
Yeah.
And no one's coming. And I'm picking, me, white guy, picking grapes. The grapes are going in slower into the bin than the rain is stacking up the bin. So the bin is filling up with rainwater, and I'm dumping buckets of, I'm floating grapes in the rainwater.
Yeah.
And about a half hour later, everybody, the 25 guys show up, and we pick the little half acre in 20 minutes. And we take it back, and I promise them all a bottle of tequila. So I delivered on that. I never told them the wine that we made out of is horrible. It was glued and tasted terrible. But that year I tried to say that.
Yeah.
You do crazy stuff when you're farming and try to make the best of different vintages. But that there is a block in the Menus that is special. And
worth maybe saving.
Yeah, I'm always waiting for it to hit the 2007 vintage again.
Yeah.
It's a long game. This grape growing business and making wine takes decades to learn and make great wine. So the good news is for those of you who like follow Turnbull for a long time,
mm-hmm.
you'll see the benefit of that. We don't always achieving it in one block, but we have four different vineyards, different appellations, amazing vineyards. And through that process and that heartful selection, we aim to put great wine in the bottle every year.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to start to wrap it up here. We're approaching an hour, but we have a little bit of stuff we wanted to get to. If we didn't get, can you go over real quick, do you have the exact blends? You said the two, the 2010 and the 2012 Leo were both about like 97%. Somebody was wondering if you had the exact or not.
They were 97 points.
97 points.
You know what? I got started on this. I was working a regular job. So I failed to like pull together the blend information. They're probably pretty similar. I could look it up right now if you want to like excuse me for a couple minutes. Or
We have a few housekeeping things I know Carrie wanted to get to. There's a couple outstanding questions here, but they're kind of long questions. So if you guys want to shoot an email to Tom at Turnbull or Peter at Turnbull Wines, we'll make sure Peter gets those answered for you. He loves to answer those questions. We're just unfortunately running out of a little bit of time here.
A few things. So we have our Merlot tasting next week. That is a vertical tasting of Merlot from our Fortuna Vineyard from 2014, 2016, but if this week's tasting is any indication, there might be some surprise, fun, older bottles of whatever we can find in our cellar that is Merlot. So if you have a Turnbull Merlot that's not 13, 14, 16, bring that out. If you'd like to load up on some 13, 14, 16 Merlot, that's all we have to sell.
Do we have 13 and 14?
We do. We don't have any of the other Merlots that maybe you're thinking of.
The 14 was fantastic.
The 14 is really good.
Yeah.
That's one of my favorites. That tasting is next Thursday at 4 p.m. Pacific time. And if you want to get it shipped in time, kind of like on my message from last week, our shipping and fulfillment partners have a lot of demand to get wine to everyone's home. So they're experiencing delays of 1 to 3 days. So just keep that in mind when placing your order. Even if you live in the middle of the country and it usually takes 4 days for something to get to you via ground, just add another 1 to 3 days onto that. So my suggestion is our $25 two-day shipping deal that we have going on. So any purchase of any four bottles or more, you can get $25 two-day shipping or $1 ground shipping if you're not in any rush to get it. We do save these videos to our YouTube channel. So if you either can't make the tasting because there's a draft going on in the NFL, or
I'm just trying to get home to the draft.
Or you've got something else going on. You can always order your wine to taste along with us later. So that's a note on shipping. We just sent out our May virtual tasting calendar about probably half an hour before this tasting went live. So we have four tastings scheduled in May at one every Thursday at 4 p.m. Pacific. The first one we have is a really cool tasting I'm very excited about with Peter. We're doing a tasting with one of our favorite local restaurants and a pretty kind of stalwart, well-known restaurant in the Napa Valley called Goose and Gander. We are making a dish paired with our 2016 Oakville Reserve with their chef, Chef Nick. So Peter and Chef will be whipping up something special and tasting that with some 2016 Oakville Reserve. We will send the recipe to you a week before that, so just hold your horses.
I can't wait to get the recipe. Actually, it was a secret dream of mine to ever have this recipe. It's absolutely the best.
If you've been to Goose and Gander, you've certainly had this item before.
Yeah.
The week after that, on the 14th, we have our 2019 Rosé and 2016 Mont Blanc tasting. The 2019 Rosé releases next Friday, May 1st.
Ooh.
So mark your calendars. We are...
Wait, is there a limit?
Well, it's for members only. So if you're not a member, you'd like to learn more about membership again, email Tom at Turnbull Wines. Maybe not Peter at Turnbull Wines, but just email Tom or reply to any of the emails you've been getting from us. We would certainly be happy to tell you more about that. But it is a members only wine because we only made 200 cases of it. It's
so not for every other member to get a bottle.
Well, it's going to be one of those things where once you get the email, I suggest going online right away and buying your case or two rosé. So that's going out on Friday, May 1st. So to celebrate that, 2 weeks later, we will have a tasting of the rosé with our Bon Vivant. On the 21st, 16
Bon Vivant is so good.
It's really good. And it's actually an interesting kind of comparison,
yeah,
because it incorporates some of the similar varietals, and it's kind of a brother-sister duo tasting.
I love that.
On sale for a limited time.
Mm-hmm.
Not
as
good, but normal discount.
On the 21st of May, we have our 2010 Aminas Vineyard Cabernet Sauvignon. So we've referenced Aminas quite a bit during this tasting, last week's tasting. We tasted 2015 last week. So
2010.
That's right.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's
got some
awesome.
good wine we get to open up.
Wow. That's fun.
And then on the 28th, the last Thursday in March, we have a barrel tasting with Peter.
Really?
Yeah. I'm glad that
I was telling him this stuff.
Yeah,
I know,
that's
sorry.
Good. That's
yeah,
good.
We were doing a tasting and
yeah,
in the cellar. So.
Oh, good. How are we going to do that with the camera?
We can do
it. Tom can tape it to the top of his head.
We'll work it out. We'll work it out.
I'm just picturing a miner's helmet and the camera.
Well, it's not really that dark in there.
No.
I think there's surfaces we can use. So that's May's calendar. That came to your emails. If you did not get an email about that, please either email Tom, email myself. I'm Carrie, C-A-R-E-Y, at TurnbullWines.com. And then that's really it for me.
Congratulations to Joe Woolley and his wife.
What? Is there news?
Our tasting room manager.
Woo, Joe!
Owen was born this morning at 11:21 a.m., 7 pounds, 6 hours, 7 pounds, 6 ounces, 26-hour labor.
Oh, my,
oh
gosh.
My goodness.
Mother and baby are doing wonderful.
Cheers to Joe, our taste room manager, and
Owen?
Baby Owen.
Owen.
Baby Woolley, as he's going to be called. Cheers to his wife, Carolina. Congratulations, you guys. It's very exciting. What a great way to wrap up this tasting.
Wow, that's amazing.
I guess on that note, I'll put our outro music on.
Yeah.
We've got
Talking Heads. This Must Be the Place.
Okay,
it's on there. You just drop the needle. Carrie's dropping the needle.
See you guys next week.
Thanks for joining us. This is a great song. Carrie had a fun story that she had in her lifetime with the song. And Talking Heads, This Must Be the Place. Great song. Meg and I had really great friends that got married a couple years ago over at the awesome Terraces Winery and at their old rustic stone ruin. And one of the participants in the wedding played this. For her partner, and it was amazing. It rekindled my interest in the song. So Wendy and Amy.
Drew to Mark Sandberg,
Mark
Baby
Sandberg.
Owen.
Yeah, Baby Owen. Everybody out there that's sequestered and drinking wine with us, we find that we're dreaming a little bit more in a good way. I did buy stock in the BayfordClinic.com. It's going to be great. We can all join up there. Tom, thanks for managing the whole thing. Tom Mendes, always on camera.
All right.
But so charismatic and handsome. He's back there doing his magic. Should we hit a game?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, let's do it.
I
want
to see the score, though.
Yeah, you
got to
do your score.
I don't think I have
it
for this one. I just have one for Black Hole.
You going first?
I could go first.
You're up.